Hi folks, if you're watching this video, you're certainly interested in Gibson guitars. But before I start to talk about the Gibson history, let's go and take a step back. String instruments were built thousands of years ago. But the first time that the string instrument was called guitar was over 4,000 years ago in Greece. The word guitar comes from the Persian word setar, and setar means three strings. So for over a few hundred, even thousand years, the guitar was played in around the Mediterranean Sea. Even in the tomb of Tutankhamun, they found some string instrument that can be called guitars. After 711, the Moors invaded Europe, Spain, and south of France. So they brought the lute to Europe. Lute means wood. Until the Baroque, time of the Baroque, the medieval time, they played some different string instruments with three strings, four strings, seven string, 11 strings. And they all called them guitars. And in the 17th century in Italy, they built a five-string guitar. And this guitar had frets and was tuned in the standard tuning we know today, ADGBE. In the middle of the 19th century, a luthier named Antonio Torres in Spain, around 1850, renewed the guitar. He built a larger body, a larger neck, six string, and tuned it in E-A-D-G-B-E, and so he was the father of the modern Spanish guitar. Orwell H. Gibson was born 1856 in Chateauguay, State New York. He moved to Kalamazoo in 1881. He worked as a shoe salesman and as a restaurant clerk. He was a keen mandolin player, but he thought that the mandolin wasn't loud enough beside the singers. So he opened his own mandolin shop for trade and repair. In 1898, he patented a new kind of building guitars and mandolins. That was the arc top. He was inspired by the violin. So he decided in 1902 to sell his Gibson factory to five Kalamazoo businessmen for $2,500. Including the sale price of $2,500, they offered him a contract for over 5 years with a monthly payment, and after that a lifelong pension. But after a dispute in 1903, Orwell Gibson left the Gibson Company, went back to Ogdensburg in State New York, and died there in 1918 at the age of 62. So it's a fact that Orwell Gibson never saw an electric guitar. Between 1903 and 1918, Gibson became the world's biggest mandolin producer. Between 1919 and 1924, Gibson started to experiment with electrical string instrument. The man behind that was Lloyd Lohr. All Gibson guitars have letters before the numbers, or most of those, like the LP, Les Paul, SG, solid guitar, ES, electric, Spanish, or the L. Some acoustics guitar or semi-acoustic guitars have an L. That means Lohr for Lloyd Lohr. Okay, I have to make a break because it's beautiful outside and I want to go skiing.
Okay.
Okay, I'm back from skiing, and let's go on. In 1921, for Gibson, invented Ted McHugh the truss rod. This metal in the neck, you can adjust the neck, and the adjustable bridge. In 1923, Gibson brought the L5 on the market. In 1928, Epaminondas Dottopulo, named Epi, founded his guitar factory, Epiphone, and soon became Gibson's biggest competitor. 1928, also Stromberg showed his first solid body electric guitar. In 1931, Adolf Rickenbacker, a Swiss-born from Basel immigrant, brought the first mass-produced electric guitar on the market. It was a steel lap, a Hawaiian guitar, and made of aluminium and metal, so the guitar was called Frying Pan. In 1935, Gibson produced only 197 ukuleles and over 20,400 guitars. In 1935, Gibson introduced their first electric solid body guitar, the EH-150, also a Hawaiian lap steel guitar. In 1936, Gibson introduced their first Spanish electric guitar, the EAS-150. The shape of the EAS-150 was the inspiration for the Les Paul for the solid body in guitar in 1952. The ES-150 was an electrified acoustic guitar, and it became famous because of Charly Christian. Charly Christian was the first solo string guitar player. In 1939, Gibson came on the market with the first cutaway guitars, the 400 model and the L5 Premier. The first ever proof of a solid body guitar was in a newspaper article in 1941. And this guitar was made in 1940 by Hedley Jones in Jamaica. But he said he was inspired by the Charly Christian Gibson guitar. In 1941, Lester Polfus, or better known as Les Paul, introduced Gibson to his first electric solid body guitar named the Log. But Gibson refused the idea to produce a solid body electric guitar at that time. The Log, the first solid body electric Les Paul guitar, in fact was an Epiphone, because Les Paul could use Epiphone's studio and produce this guitar with Epiphone wood. During the Second World War, Gibson had serious problems because of the lack of sales, the craftsmanship, and the material. So they were forced to sell the company to CMI, Chicago Musical Instruments, in 1944. In 1946, Leo Fender established his company in Fullerton, California. In 1948, Paul Bixby introduced the Merle Travis, the first solid body electric guitar, and inspired Leo Fender for the Telecaster. In 1949, CMI, Chicago Musical Instruments, hired Ted McCarty for Gibson guitars. And that was the beginning of the golden age of Gibson. In 1950, Leo Fender introduced to the market the world's first mass-produced electric solid body guitar. The first guitar were named Esquire, but this was a low-price guitar with just one pickup for an affordable price, but the market asked for a better quality, so he changed quickly to the broadcaster, but the broadcaster was a Gretsch own name, so he had to rename this guitar to Telecaster. In 1950, Ted McCarty became the CEO of Gibson. Surprised by Leo Fender's success, Ted McCarty decided also to produce a solid body guitar, and he gave the order to his engineers to produce a solid body electric guitar. Gibson's engineers found out that Lloyd Lohr in 1923 already had produced a prototype of a solid body electric violin. So based on Lloyd Lohr's designs, they produced some prototypes. But the first prototypes were too heavy, so they searched and finally they made the guitar, and the prototype name was Deranger. In 1951, Clarence Havanga, or named Mr. Gibson, traveled around the country to show the prototype, the Ranger, to their clients and to CMI in Chicago. When Clarence Havanga, Mr. Gibson, came back with the results, he convinced Ted McCarty to start production of a solid body electric guitar. Ted McCarty didn't want to fail, so he decided to bring the Deranger out as a signature model, and he looked on the market for a famous guitar player and musician. The decision came to Les Paul. Les Paul had three big hits in a row in the 50s, 1950 and 1951, and so he invited Les Paul to Kalamazoo and showed him the prototype. CMI CEO Maurice Berlin wasn't convinced with the flat top. He was a keen violin collector. So he said to Ted McCarty, if he put an arc top, a rounded top on the guitar, he would give his okay. And Les Paul, he made the decision of the color. He wanted the gold guitar because Leo Fender produced his guitar in the car colors, blue, green, red. So Les Paul said we should go out with a gold top. It's a fact that Les Paul didn't design the Les Paul. He just chose the color and the tailpiece. In 1952, the first solid body electric guitar Gibson made came on the market. That was the gold top. In 1954, Gibson improved the quality of the Les Paul because the first Les Paul, the P90, had too much noise. The quality wasn't good enough, so they improved the P90 to a much higher quality, and Ted McCarty invented the Tune-O-Matic bridge. In the same year, they introduced the first custom Les Paul black. So they had two colors, the gold top, the standard, and the black top, the custom. In 1955, Seth Lover invented the humbucker for Gibson. A single coil is wired round magnets. And then when you plug in the guitar, it starts to turn the electric field. And it starts to hum, makes a hum. And Seth Lover had the idea to put two single coil together, but to turn one in the other side. And when you put them together, they turn against each other, and so they stop humming. But they are less bright than a single coil. The first Les Paul were sold for $210, but in 1956, the sales of Les Paul guitars reached a peak with 3,129 sold guitars. The standard was sold for $247.50, and the custom was sold for $395. In 1957, Gibson improved the quality of the humbuckers. They are now famous as the PAF, patent applied for, or the 57 humbuckers. That was the beginning of the myth of the Les Paul. In the same year, Gibson bought the Epiphone factory for $20,000. Even though the Les Paul was now the maybe ever best built electric guitar, solid body electric guitar, the sales dropped. So Ted McCarty was forced to bring out new models. In 1958, Gibson came on the market with quite a few new models. They came on the market with the Explorer, the Flying V, the ES-335, and they improved the look, the wood quality of the Les Paul. They changed the gold top or the black ones and brought out for the first time sunburst where you could see the wood through the color. In 1959, they tried to upgrade the Les Paul for a last time. They put the better veneer on the 59. They upgraded the humbuckers to a 59 humbuckers. They slimmed down a bit the neck, and so the 59 Les Paul came on the market. But in 1960, they stopped the production of the Les Paul, and over 3 years, between 58 and 60, they made around 1,700 sunburst guitar and a louder slightly over 640 guitars in 1959. The retail price in 1959 for a standard sunburst Les Paul was $265. If you want now one to buy one of these beauties, you have to pay over $500,000. So in 1960, Gibson stopped the production of the Les Paul. This is a 1959 reissue. And they brought out in 1961 the new Les Paul, a double cut. In 1962, the 10-year contract with Les Paul was running out. But Les Paul didn't want to renew the contract with Gibson because he was in a divorce battle with his wife, Mary Ford. And he feared to pay too much to Mary, so he stopped gigging, he stopped recording, and he stopped to taking royalties for his name. And in 1963, because Gibson didn't have a contract anymore with Les Paul to use his name, so they were forced to change the Les Paul SG, and they renamed it simply SG, that means solid guitar. In 1965, Gibson produced for the first time in their history over 100,000 guitars. In 1966, Ted McCarty bought Bixby and he left Gibson, and that was the end of the Ted McCarty era. In the late 60s, when the pop music became a bit harder, Eric Clapton, Jimmy Page, George Harrison, Peter Green, they rediscovered the Les Paul, and young musicians asked for a Les Paul, so Gibson decided in 1968 to restart the production of Les Paul. My dog woke up, it's park time, I have to go for a walk. In 1969, ECL, an Ecuadorian brewery, was interested to buy Gibson. So CMI, the owner of Gibson, Chicago Musical Instrument, made the joint venture with ECL. The new company who owned Gibson was named Norlin. Norlin comes from Norton Stevens, the CEO of ECL, and from Berlin Lean, from Maurice Berlin, the CEO of CMI. Norlin decided to make a lot of money with the Gibson brand. Norlin bought cheaper wood, hired younger staff, lower wages, and cheaper specs. So in fact, Norlin did all the faults you can do when you have a good company and you want to make a bigger profit and you squeeze this company. So you lower the quality, the wages, the material, and fast after 1970-71, the rumor started that the Gibson quality was much lower than in the 50s and 60s. 1974, Norlin decided to build a second plant in Tennessee. So they had the plant in Kalamazoo and the plant in Tennessee. Because of the lack of the quality, the sales dropped. Some Gibson enthusiasts started to improve the quality of the Les Paul. The most famous of them is Paul Red Smith, now famous for his guitars, the PRS. Gibson's falling was so fast they had to make serious job cuts to improve their sales, and they made some signature models like the BB King or the Jet Atkins. But the quality was so low, people didn't start or restart to buy Gibson guitars. So in 1985, the staff of Gibson were down to 100 employees, and Norlin desperately searched somebody to sell the company. Rumors even say Norlin asked $1. In January 1986, Henry Juszkiewicz and David Berryman bought Gibson guitars and restarted. Henry Juszkiewicz, an Argentina-born original from Poland immigrant, brought Gibson back on track. He restarted with the vintage models, the Les Paul, the ES-335 and the SGs, beside the acoustic guitars. Henry Juszkiewicz soon after stabilized the financial problems of Gibson. He improved the quality. Henry Juszkiewicz started with 70 employees, but the success came so fast back, he had to employ people, and now even over 1,200 people works again for Gibson. In 2003, Gibson opened his own plant for Epiphone guitars in China. In 2009 and 2011, Gibson was raided by the Department of Justice. They were accused to use protected wood from Madagascar, and they were fined with $300,000. 2015 was a bad year again for Gibson because they wanted to improve their vintage. They wanted to improve their vintage line to a more modern line, the HP, that means high performance. And they made wider necks, a different nut messing instead of plastic or bone, and the G-force, the self-tuning, and the click-in scratch plate. But people didn't like all those changes, so 2015 was a bad year for Gibson, and now they produce both lines, the T means traditional, and the HP, the high performance line. I believe 3/4 of the sales they have now, they are traditional. The future for Gibson isn't easy. The future for Gibson won't be easy because Paul Red Smith started, beside his high-end guitars, also to produce between the high-end guitars American-made and the lower-priced Asian-made the SC line. He started to produce now also in the mid-range American-built guitars. On the other hand, Fender spreads also their line of guitars. Beside their single coils, traditional single coils, they produce more and more also guitars with humbuckers. And the shape of necks, you can have a kind of slim tapper neck, the modern C, you can have the classical C, you can have the U, V shape, high gloss shape, satin neck, and naked necks. And that makes it harder for Gibson for the future, because the competitors comes closer and closer. A second problem for Gibson in the future will be the wood. It's not so easy to get the right wood anymore, and Gibson traditionally has rosewood fretboards, and rosewood is highly sought after now and highly protected. And finally, also in Asia, they improve the quality of the guitars, and they are much better priced than the American made. So the future for Gibson won't be easy, but I'm sure they will find a way. Gibson is today the fourth biggest guitar manufacturer in the world. Number one is Samick, South Korea. Number two is Cort, also South Korea. Number three is Fender USA, and number four is Gibson USA. I hope there were some new information for you about Gibson, and thank you for watching. Thank you.